Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Dear brothers and sisters, and those who are present before me, and those who will listen later, to all of you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today I will discuss about political thought of Islam. I will first start with this, that before Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find only monarchies, no democracy. Though it is said that Athens, a small state or town or city in Greece, had a kind of democracy, but it was limited to one city only, and that was also not a full democracy in the sense that of a Khilafat of Abu Bakr, or in the sense of UK democracy. So only we find in history, in Islamic history or in the Quran, that there are a few prophets who ruled. Most of them did not rule. All of them did not rule, except I find Musa alayhi salam and Dawud alayhi salam and Sulaiman alayhi salam. They ruled over their areas. But we do not know from the Quran or any other source what was the style of administration, or what was the style of their government or bureaucracy or whatever it is. We can understand only this, we can guess, we can presume that they followed the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they followed justice. This we can understand, but we cannot spell out the details. Now we come to the Prophet's time. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in Makkah al-Mukarramah. This was not a state, it was a city, Makkah, where several dynasties used to live. The main dynasty was Quraysh, but there are others. And there was not a single administration in Makkah, so it was not a state. So here he lived and became prophet at the age of 40. And then he again continued to preach in Makkah and then went to Medina. On the 53rd year of his life, he went to Medina. And there he gave the Medina Charter, or Misaq al-Medina, or Medina Constitution. This was, it is said sometime, that it is the first written constitution of the world, not the US Constitution. US Constitution was written much later. This is what he said. So, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the Medina Sanad or Medina document, Medina Constitution, and it said that all of them, all the people of Medina, whether belong to Aus or Khazraj or Jews of various groups or mushriks, all are citizens of Medina and they have equal rights. All of them have to safeguard the city. They have to bear, all groups have to bear their own expenses, and any difference will be dealt with by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the leader of the Medina, and the Quran. It said that any difference will be settled according to the Quran and according to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instruction. So this was the first constitution of Islam, and it clearly says that all will have rights and equal rights. It also says the state, it established the first state. There was no state in Arabia. There was no state in Medina. The state was established by this agreement. And then the next important issue for constitutional principles was Hajjul Bida, or farewell pilgrimage. In that, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam declared in his speech very clearly that all human beings are equal. He said Arabs are not superior to non-Arabs, non-Arabs are not superior to Arabs, and blacks are not superior to whites, whites are not superior to whites, or whites on blacks. So it means that all human beings are equal, men and women, because Arabs also include men and women, blacks also include men and women, and whites also include men and women. So in other words, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that all human beings are equal and no difference except piety, except taqwa. And he also said that in this the life, three things are protected. The life, that is blood. He said blood is haram, of all, blood of all, that is life of all. And izzat, honor, is protected, and property, protected. These are the fundamental rights given by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So this is a very major document, and there was no greater speech than this speech in the history of human being. If any prize is to be given, the prize for any speech is to be given, the prize should go to this speech of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now, Prophet's third important thing in political contribution is that he died at the age of 63 but did not nominate his successor. He did not nominate a Khalifa. That is, he left it open so that a true people's government can emerge, so that a truly elective government can emerge. And we know that after the death of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was elected by the Sahabas of Medina. Main Sahabis were there in Medina only. And he was elected. And he was accepted by all. Even if one or two had difference, but then they also accepted bayah or allegiance to him. And so the Prophet ﷺ did not select. He allowed the Ummah to select. He intentionally, according to Allah's wish, wanted that elected government come after me, after the Prophet. Because there will be no more Prophet. So only the rulers will be there, and the rulers will be elected. And Abu Bakr was elected, Umar was also elected, in the sense that Abu Bakr proposed his name and people accepted him. And Usman and Abu Ali, more or less same. So this elected principle came, that the law will be Sharia, the law will be administered by Qazis or the judges, and the ruler will be elected. But a change came at the time after Amir Muawiyah. He maintained all things. He maintained the Sharia, he maintained that the Quran and Sunnah will be the law, he maintained the judges will be free and independent, and they will decide cases, but the ruler will be from the family of the Umayyads. After him Yazid, and after him his son, after him his relation or son, etc. So this was a big change. So though the Umayyads and Abbasids call this Khilafat, but this Khilafat and Abu Bakr's Khilafat is not same. It is Khilafat, no doubt, because history has recorded that as Khilafat for many reasons. One reason is that the main law was Sharia. And everything was according to Sharia or according to Allah's law, except only the ruler. And they thought it is permissible. They thought that nomination is permissible. The whole world now says, Islamic scholarship now says, that it was not right. But still, at that time they thought that this is also permissible, they thought. In any case, then this Khilafat was like that, became mixed monarchy and Khilafat, but mainly Khilafat and partly monarchy it became. It continued up to the end of Usmani Khilafat. And then the colonialism, and that all Muslim states almost all became colony, and then they became free. First state who became free was Pakistan in 1947, and then Indonesia in 1947, etc. The question then came of preparing constitution for the country, because in the earlier times, in the earlier time, written constitution was not necessary. There was no written constitution except the United States of America. No written constitution. But later, it became fashion that all countries must have written constitution. So except Britain, all countries, France, Germany, Italy, all had written constitution. So the question came that in Pakistan also there should be written constitution. If it is said that the constitution is the Quran and Sunnah, there will be debate. There will be debate there, what is say Quran says, what Sunnah says. So the full constitution was written. And there was a debate that what will be the type of constitution, or what will be the basic provisions of that constitution. Ulama sat together and decided that there should be 20-25 principles which should be incorporated in the constitution. For example, all are citizens, all will have rights, sovereignty over universe, and Pakistan or Muslim country will be Allah, and the ruler, authority will be from the people. People will be, but that will be the sacred trust. He is not an independent owner. He is a ruler, sacred trust. It is a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is under Allah. So this constitution was made, and first constitution, Islamic constitution. And this has become model for the world. And then Iran also made a constitution. Ulama made, and people supported it. That is also based on Islamic provisions, Allah's sovereignty, people's authority, election, parliament, judiciary, everything. So now, political thought is basically represented by a constitution. It is there, and all any country can now adopt it. So I finish here that in practice, the constitution of Iran and Pakistan should be thought to be the basis of the Islamic political thought. Thank you.